So all these images in this deck right here that's been running are images that club members have taken, not always locally, but and sometimes using robotic scopes across the internet. But you know, these are all things that you can do with equipment here, or like I said, by renting time on bigger telescopes. But I'll go ahead and switch to the lecture presentation here. The end. Oh, that was quick. Oh, that's not the right one. Okay. So normally what I do is give a lecture that's kind of an overview of all different kinds of nighttime photography and some tips and tricks that are sort of common techniques that you need for those. And then and so the rest of us are setting up gear and waiting to be able to see Polaris, because we need to align to true north, and Polaris is close to true north for our scopes to track the stars properly, and we'll talk more about that. So this makes a good time from twilight until we can see Polaris to do a lecture. So in this latest version of this lecture, I added all these QR codes, and I got about halfway through before I remembered there's no internet access out here. But I guess if you take pictures of the slides, you can probably trigger the QR codes later. So first, a bit of a commercial about SJAA. So you probably all know about our meetup site, because that's probably how you found out about this and got here. So there's 1,500 of you on Meetup that have joined the Meetup group. And then the club has sja.net on the left here. And so that's the club website that has some more information there. So what do? So we do education and public outreach. We do, I think, at least three star parties a month, two at Hoagie Park in San Jose, and usually one at Rancho Cañada de Oro, which you probably passed and didn't know it when you came. It's down that way. And that's another thing that we do in cooperation with the Open Space Preserve. And so that's a nice dark site, and it's got a regular bathroom, well, regular camping bathroom. You know, there'll be a whole row of observers there doing visual observing, and you can go from scope to scope and look at different things and ask questions and stuff. So that's a nice site. And the in-town ones are, you know, a lot of light pollution, but you know, if you've got kids and don't want to drive or something, those are okay too. We do school star parties. We have a loaner program. You know, I was chatting with the gentleman here. Like to catch people before they go and spend money to, you know, have them borrow things and see what type of scope they like and if they're really interested in astronomy or not, before spending money, so that they can find out, you know, kind of the most efficient thing to buy for what they want to do. So we have loaner programs and we have classes. Okay, let's see. Yeah, intro to night classes. There's a book library. Once a month, we have our board meeting at Hoagie Park, and then a speaker, and that's a good time to browse the book library. Besides these, in terms of astrophotography, I do this once a month, twice in a quarter, and then the third month is club members only. Come out here, and I don't do a lecture, and we just image and we help each other kind of thing. So I call that a field clinic. That's not on Meetup, it's on a club Google group. Let's see, what else? We do swap meets, just had one a couple weeks ago. Solar observing. One Sunday a month at Hoagie Park, they have solar observing, and also a fix-it for if you have problems with your telescope or you don't know how to use it or whatever, you can make a reservation and go and get help. There, okay. All right, so let's get into the lecture. Oh, and that was supposed to be a commercial. So I said there's like 1,500 people that are on the meetup, but there's only like 400 people that have forked over $20 to be a club member. So it would help. You know, $20 a year is not a lot for all of the things that the club provides. So that would be helpful and to join, and almost more than the money to, you know, buy more equipment for the loaner program, etc. What we really need are more volunteers to help with programs. So if you think you might be interested in that, we've got a notebook with job descriptions and stuff. And so coming to one of those speaker nights, board meeting speaker nights, you could talk with various board members and stuff and see if what volunteer positions are available. So that would be great. And to join, you just go to the sja.net and there's a tab for joining through PayPal. Okay. Intro to astrophotography. So this image on the left is the Lagoon Nebula, and it's one of the very first images that I felt I was successful at. It was taken with a DSLR from Scotts Valley, and this was something that got me excited and got me kind of going into the hobby. That photo on the right is actually from a Rancho Cañada de Oro star party I mentioned, so you can see there all the astronomers set up down the row. Then this is where I got to after maybe the second year, 2 or 3 years maybe. So this is actually a mosaic of, meaning that there's three different pictures here that are merged together. So, you know, the right hand, the middle, and the left to make this bigger frame. And I did this using robotic telescopes in Australia. And it's a composite image of about 250 separate exposures. So it's a monochrome camera through a luminance filter, through a red filter, through a green filter, through a blue filter, and then the three different frames. So that's kind of what you do to put deep space astrophotography together. So this is got some real popular targets in it, and that's one reason why it's a nice mosaic to put together. On the right we have the Great Nebula in Orion, also known as Messier 42, the Running Man, Messier 43, right next to it, and then the Horsehead Nebula. Can you see the little horse head sticking up right there? And the Flame Nebula. And so there's a lot of stuff going on here. And we'll see this over and over again. Okay, so in this lecture, we're going to cover nightscapes, star trails, time lapse, wide field, planetary, and we'll get into the deep space nebulas and galaxies. That's only part of what you can do with astrophotography. There's also solar, which takes, you know, a little different technique, specialized equipment. And there's also now electronically assisted astronomy, which is sort of halfway between visual and astrophotography. And this is where you know, start with an eyepiece, and then at some point you take the eyepiece out and put in a video camera, and then you can look on a little screen and see things that way. Also not covered is the whole area of citizen science. So there's a whole bunch of stuff that you can do, science, and there's even ways that astronomers, professional astronomers, will use your help to get data that they need, or to you know, blink between photographs to identify moving targets and different things. So there's some gamification and other things that they're doing for the public to help them out. So for instance, there's the whole area of photometry, which is how bright it is, which, you know, you use to study variable stars, nova, supernova, asteroids, exoplanets. I think they're in college now, but two kids in the program that were in high school, and they actually worked on exoplanets. In fact, they worked on exoplanets so well that NASA is now using some of their software they developed in their chain of software to discover exoplanets. So that was pretty exciting. Astrometry, you know, identifying where in the sky things are at what time. Spectroscopy, what color is it, which tells you something's chemical composition, the star type, you know, kind of what's going on. And you can also use spectroscopy to measure redshift and blue shift to tell how fast something is moving towards or away from the Earth relatively. Okay, so there's some links there. But let's get into the things we are going to cover. So first, let's start with some resources that are really handy. Astrobin.com. You can think of it as sort of a very mild Facebook for astrophotographers. There's not a huge amount of social on there, but you know, you like people post their photos and you like them, and that's about as Facebook as it gets. But and this is my page on the right here. But what is super cool about this, I think, as a resource when you're starting out is, you know, you don't know. You look in a catalog or online or something and, you know, here's this telescope and you don't know what you can do with it. But on Astrobin, you can put it in as a search term, right? So, you know, Celestron Edge 11, and then you can see what people have done with that and with cameras and how they fit together and all that stuff. And you can also see people, well, they started with this, but now they moved on to this and they're getting these really great pictures and stuff. So it's a great resource. And most people also fill out these technical cards. So not only do you know all the equipment that they use, but you know how many exposures they took and how long they were and, you know, kind of the whole details of everything. So that's real handy. All right, so let's start out with kind of the most accessible nighttime photography, right? Just a camera and a tripod. So, you know, some examples, you can do star trails, you can take a picture of the Milky Way, and we have some examples here of different Milky Way shots with different lens sizes. So, already talked about nightscapes being the most accessible, and so you might wonder about lenses. So you probably, you know, a lot of people have a DSLR and a zoom lens, and that's fine. If you start getting into, you know, getting perfectly round stars, if you zoom in Photoshop or something and look at star shapes in some of these things, they'll be not round, they'll be triangles or bent to one side or something. And so the desire is to have more natural looking stars, and you'll have much more luck with what's called a prime lens than a zoom lens, right? So a prime lens is a fixed focus lens, and you don't need to buy the latest and greatest with, you know, ultrasonic motion control and all this stuff, because you're not going to use any of that at night, right? So you might find an older, manual lens will do better than a modern lens. Focusing at night is a challenge. We'll give you some techniques and tools for that. And another thing that can happen is if you're leaving your camera out at certain times of the year in certain locations, you know, you can get dew on it, you can get condensation. The first time I tried to do a time lapse, I set my camera out on a tripod on the hillside in Scotts Valley and let it run, and when I came out in the morning, it was completely covered over with dew, and the time lapse starts you know, blue and the stars are moving, and then it just turns brown and there's no stars. So we'll talk about ways of doing dew control. And that's a problem all the way up into, you know, full-size telescopes as well. If you're not trying to do star trails, your exposure is going to be limited by, you know, how long you can expose before you do get a star trail. And there's something called the rule of 500, which will tell you about, which will help you avoid star trails. And then, you know, obviously ISO is another factor. You know, the higher you turn it up, the more noise you have, but you kind of have to do that sometimes to get the shot. So we'll talk about those details as well. This is an example of what can be done. This Mark Strybeck is a club member, and he also blogs about his journeys in astrophotography. So this is one of his pictures, and you can read a blog there about how he made that image. This is also Mark's. This is an example of star trails. So in this case, he pointed the camera. Oh, look at all these clouds. Well, I hope that blows through. Pointed his camera at Polaris, and therefore all the stars are going to appear to rotate, right? So in this case, he did, that's interesting. He did 4 hours of 30-second exposures and then put them all together in Photoshop. And again, just a DSLR on a tripod. Okay, this is a movie. So the next level of difficulty would be creating a time lapse. And I just kind of grabbed one randomly off the internet here, and it takes a while to get to the night part, but gives you an idea of some of the things you can do. So the best software for this is a combination of Adobe Lightroom and a program called LR Timelapse. And if you go to LRTimelapse.com, there's some great tutorials by this guy that writes the software, and his wife have gone all over the world and done amazing time lapses, and he's really good at the tutorials as well. And you'll notice, like right now, the camera's appearing to move as well as the sky is moving, right? So you can start to add motorized track or a motorized handheld or something to add more drama to your time lapse. You can also, what they call painting with light, you can light your foreground, or you can take a flashlight and paint the rocks or whatever. We had a gentleman in the club. There's a chimney over here by the porta potty in the old cabin, and he made a time lapse looking this way, and he walked over with the red flashlight and the chimney came out really nice. So some interesting things start to happen here. You have the same challenges, focuses, and dew control, but you have now a new thing called aperture flicker. So it turns out when you're using your DSLR, you know, normally it's the lens is wide open when you're looking through it or looking at the LCD on the back. And then you press the shutter and it stops down to where it's actually going to be to take the picture, and then it opens back up again. So it turns out if you're going to be taking hundreds or thousands of pictures for a time lapse, it doesn't actually go to the exact same diameter every time, and you can get kind of a flicker effect. So at the LR time lapse, he talks about some ways to correct that in software. There's also a trick you can do, you know, which is unlock your lens bayonet and move it just slightly enough to disconnect the electrical contacts. So now it's a dumb manual lens, and obviously you need to be careful not to have it fall out on the ground. But that's one trick that you can use there. Okay. All right, the next level of complication or tool that you need to make progress is some type of a tracker that you can put your DSLR on that will then track the stars. So I think not this telescope, but the next gentleman over, Werner, is setting up one of those. So you can check that out. So this is going to be like the least expensive tracking mount. They're going to be $250, $350 around there. And now that you're tracking the stars, you can start taking longer exposures and not have the star trail. You do. They are essentially little baby German equatorial mounts, which is what all astrophotographers pretty much use. Hey, yes. Hi.
How are you?
Okay. And so there's the right ascension, which rotates with the stars, and the axis of that needs to be pointed directly at true north. And so we use polar alignment. Polaris is close to true north. And what you do is you have an app on your phone or something here that tells you for where you are and what time it is. You need to put Polaris, if you look through your little polar scope, which comes with these things, you need to put Polaris, which is the brightest star in that region of the sky, you need to put Polaris right on that part of the reticle, and then the center will be pointed at true north. So that's polar alignment. And it's basically the same technique that gets used on bigger and bigger telescopes as well. Other than that, you have the same challenges as nightscapes, focus, due control, we'll talk about. But now you're starting to get multiple images of the same object as it moves across the sky, so that you can start stacking the images. So not to be confused with HDR stacking, where you're taking the same object during the daytime at different aperture settings for a wider contrast range. This is called temporal stacking, because you're stacking things that are taken across time, but because we're tracking, they're going to appear to be static, and so what happens is the noise, which is random, will get averaged out, and the detail which you're tracking and are going to align in every shot is going to start to stand out more. And also, I'm getting ahead of myself. Dithering is something that we'll talk about when we get to the deep space. Let's see. Oh, these things normally don't come with a piece of gear that you need to make them work. And I've never quite understood why, but you need a ball head. So if you look at this bottom picture here, you'll see that it's just sort of a 3/8 inch professional tripod thread there. And so to actually attach your DSLR and be able to point your DSLR to different parts of the sky, you need to add a good ball head. And so both the ball head and the mount need to be rated for, you know, the heaviest lens and camera that you're gonna put on there. Okay. And then you'll use your regular tripod head. You also have to have this thing level. So ideally your tripod head is going to have a level on it, or some of these come with a level as well. At this point, you might want to start shooting tethered. What do we mean by tethered shooting? That means controlling the camera with a laptop. And so there's, if you've got a Canon or a Nikon, there's a popular program called Backyard EOS for Canon or Backyard Nikon. And with that, you can do a lot of stuff. There's aids for focusing, and there's live view for doing planetary and some other things. So that's a good piece of software to start with. There are other free ones, there's a competing one, I think, called APT that I think also works with one of the few, if not the only, software that works with Sony mirrorless cameras. Okay, and unfortunately, speaking of tethering and mirrorless cameras, The camera manufacturers have purposely decided that they're not going to give you the ability to control mirrorless cameras through the USB cable or Wi-Fi. They've just decided that that's how they're going to differentiate between DSLRs and mirrorless cameras. So there's no formal software SDK or API that software developers can use for mirrorless cameras, but in the case of APT, he has managed to figure it out on his own without Sony's support. Okay, so another thing here now. So now, if you're starting to put longer focal length lenses on the camera at this point, it's going to be difficult to find your object. So you might need to add a wider field, some type of scope or telescope finder, like on the hot shoe or something, so that you can get in a wider field onto your target and then work out the fine details with the LCD. So that's something now that has to be aligned, right? Those two, your camera and that finder. So you're going to want to do that during the day. So find a tree or a radio tower or a telephone pole or something, and during the day align the finder, which can be a red dot finder or a wider finder scope, and the center of your frame in the DSLR, and then at night you'll be able to use that. Okay. So the next level up would be to actually use a full-on telescope mount, right? So a German equatorial mount. So maybe you've got one and a bigger telescope, which you use for deep space, but you want to do wider field. So there's ways to either a DSLR, or here I'm showing dedicated astronomy cameras on a Canon lens in this case. And you can just mount that on the top of the telescope and use the more beefy and accurate telescope mount to do these wider field images. So that's the North American and Pelican Nebula there, using this rig on the right. From now I'm in Union City. So what else? So when it comes to buying a German equatorial mount, it does need to be the most expensive part of your rig. It should be like 50 to 70% of your budget. It's more important than the camera. It's more important than the telescope. And the reason for this is if you don't get a quality enough, a beefy enough mount, you're gonna not be successful in the hobby. You're gonna be hating it and be frustrated and not enjoying it. But if you follow the lead and get a quality mount, everything is much easier. And so that's important to understand how your budget should be arranged. We do have the Orion store in town. It's one of the very few remaining telescope stores around, kind of like camera stores, and they do sell mounts there. So the Orion Atlas Pro, which is what Jerry has right here, is really the minimum mount that I would recommend. They're going to try to sell you something smaller and less expensive in the hopes that you're going to come back and buy again another mount. So don't do that. And it all depends on the weight of the equipment that you're going to go on, that you're going to put on it. So first thing you have to do is cut what they advertise, cut that in half, and be sure to think about, well, not this first telescope, but what might I want to do later, and spend the money on the mount to make that work long term. Okay, then there's planetary. So this is now kind of a completely different approach for, you know, galaxies and nebulas and to some extent nightscapes. You know, we're taking long exposures, and planets are super, super bright compared to other things, and they're also really small, so you need a lot of magnification. So and if you've ever, you know, you look at the moon, or maybe you've looked at Saturn through a telescope, and you can see it kind of waving around, right? So that's the currents in the air. And the way that we get around that for planets is we shoot really, really, really short exposures. In fact, it's essentially video. So the shorter exposure you can get, the more chance that you'll catch a moment of clean air, so to speak. And then we have software that stacks those in a different way, and it's called lucky imaging. So you're looking for, oh, I was lucky and I got this little piece of this image in focus while the rest of it was out, right? So it's going to go through and figure out the sharpest detail in all these different parts of these different frames, and then it's going to make a composite image of the best of the best. So that's the planetary, and it's interesting with deep space and to a certain extent nightscape. You know, we're usually trying to take relatively big sections of the sky compared to planetary, and we're trying to do long exposures. So a lot of times we're going to be adding focal reduction, or you might know it as a teleconverter, you know, to lenses or to telescopes, to both make the field of view wider and to lower the f-stop so we can get you know, more detail in a shorter exposure. With planetary, it's kind of exactly the opposite. You're probably going to be adding something called a Barlow to the telescope, which is the opposite. You're going to be multiplying the magnification versus reducing it with a focal reducer. Okay, and then I mentioned here the Registax, and then there's another one which I'm drawing a blank on at the moment. Otto Stackert, I think it's German, is the other planetary stacking software that's, and I think they're both free. Oh, and so solar could fall in this category as well. So there you see a solar prominence. All right, deep sky. This is where my heart is, right? So nebulas and galaxies and globular clusters, right? So that's the good news, is that it's exciting and there's all these amazing objects out there that look like eyeballs and skulls and ghosts and all kinds of crazy stuff. There was a great, NASA has the astrophoto of the day, called an APOD, astrophoto of the day. And today is Gravity's Grin. So I pull up this image and it's like a smiley face because it's two bright pink objects. And then a gravitational lens has caused a smile. So there's a galaxy behind these bright objects, and they're so massive that the light is bending around them into a smile. So it looks like a big smiley face. So anyway, there's some amazing stuff out there. So that's the good news. And, you know, bright colors that you do with narrowband imaging and all that. Sort of the bad news is that, you know, it's somewhat technically challenging, right? It's the most expensive, it's the most complex, it's mechanically sensitive, which we'll talk about. Well, we'll talk about it right now. So why do these mounts have to be so expensive? So think about what they're trying to do. So we'll talk about seeing for a minute, right? So we talked about, you know, the air moving, right, and messing up your view of planets. Well, that same air is messing up your view of galaxies and nebulae as well. And so there's a term for that called seeing, and It's measured in arc seconds. So what's an arc second? So, you know, a circle is 360 degrees. If you break that up into minutes, an arc minute, it's, you know, 60th of a degree, and then arc second is a 60th of an arc minute. Okay? So amateur seeing is about 2 arc seconds, by which I mean that, you know, if you're not at an observatory class location, which has been carefully planned out with laminar flow coming up from the ocean or something on a mountaintop, you know, the best you can hope for is around 2 arc seconds of seeing, which means that when we sample, you know, we want our tracking to be accurate to about twice that. That's Nyquist's sampling theorem, right? So we want a 1 arc second basically accuracy is what we'd like to have. So what is an arc second? So if I take a golf ball, right, about that big, and I move it out 5 miles, that's about an arc second of width. So that's how accurate these consumer mass-produced mounts still need to be, and that's why you know, they can get expensive, because they're trying to be that accurate. Okay, yeah. So you may have 5 or 6 pieces of software that are talking to all the different equipment that you have. So there's, and you know USB, which was never meant to be outside, and all this stuff. So there's issues, right? And so you could look at it as that's an exciting challenge, and for some of us that are, you know, Silicon Valley people, for me it was like kind of the perfect storm of software and hardware and a little bit of art thrown in, and you know, but I don't want to scare you off, but I also want to you know, deep sky is challenging. Oh, and this would be a good time for my joke about astrophotography. So you go to a star party and there's a visual guy with a Dobsonian, right? And so, and then there's an astrophotography guy next to him. And so the visuals guy is doing his thing and he's looking at objects, and he looks over at the astrophotographer and he says, "Hey, I'm on my 13th object. Where are you?" You know, and the guy's counterweight, USB. So the Dobsonian guys will, you know, that's like the simplest telescope you can get. It's called a push to. You push it and look in it, and you're done, right? And then you look at the next object. So anyway, how's it going, Jerry? You see Polaris? Okay. Are you cursing yet? Did you forget your counterweights?
I was cursing earlier.
Okay. All right. So I'm joking. You know, that's a typical move, is you get all your stuff together and you drive 2 hours and you go to set it up and you forgot your counterweights, or you forgot one USB cable or whatever. So make a checklist. It sounds silly. Make a checklist. Okay, but yeah, so I carry extra counterweights and extra batteries with me, because that's the kind of stuff people forget. Like I said, so you probably have multiple pieces of software that you need all of to make this thing, you know, work in the most automated way. Now there are guys that will, you know, bah humbug all this stuff, and they go out and they do astrophotography with just an intervalometer and a mount, and they don't auto guide and all this stuff. That's great, but the way most people do it is they have a planetarium program, they have a mount driver, they have autofocus, they have image capture software, they have a plate solver, they have auto guiding, and they have software that makes all these things work together, so they can go to bed and this thing will, you know, run and all night basically. There is starting to be, so you'll see some people here have laptops, they're running Windows, and there's astronomy standards that are Windows based, and so that's where you tend to get a lot of software. But there's also the concept of you know, putting a Raspberry Pi or a nook or something right up on the telescope, and that has some advantages in less cabling, which is good, because another thing USB wasn't meant for is long distances. And there's open source software called K-STARS, which is pretty much everything you need all in one package. And you know, you can buy that computer with K-STARS on it for like $179. So that's an approach. And there's some guys in the club that are doing that, and I've tried it, and I can see it all works. But it's not any less complicated to put all the settings in than it is to put all the settings in all these different pieces of software. So just keep that in mind. Okay, so we covered the different types. Let's talk about some of the tips and techniques. So I already talked about prime lenses, right? So the prime lenses are going to give you sharper, smaller stars compared to a zoom lens. So you know, you can pick up used lenses, or you can look on Astrobin and see what type of lenses people are using for what types of pictures. And I've listed here some places you can get used lenses. Of course, there's also eBay if you trust your luck on that. Focal length. So on the left here, we're showing for both for full frame and crop sensor cameras what different lenses will look like on the sky. And then on the right, using a planetarium program, I have kind of extended that into telescope range. And so in the very center, you can see at, you know, the 1,000 millimeter, that's M42, the Great Orion Nebula, and the Horsehead Nebula is over here on the left of the and the Flame Nebula of the 150 millimeter frame. So you can kind of get a sense of that. Oh, and I forgot to tell you where the Great Nebula in Orion is. So you guys all know what Orion, the constellation of Orion, looks like. The Hunter, right? It's easy to find. He's got the three stars as a belt. Yes? Okay. So below his belt on the right, down a bit, there's like a little sparkly thing. And it's like some people call it his dagger or his sword. That's the Great Nebula in Orion. So you can actually see it with the naked eye as a little sparkly object. So that's kind of cool. And I forgot that, you know, those three stars, they are his belt. I forgot when I showed you my Orion mosaic that star, bright star next to the Flame Nebula, is one of the stars in his belt. Okay, so I said focusing was a problem. Now I'm going to tell you how to have it not be a problem. So first thing is find a bright star or even a planet, right? So the brighter the object is, the easier it's going to be to focus on. Don't try to look through the viewfinder. Use your LCD and use the magnification on your LCD. And then some people even carry these little plastic or, you know, jeweler's loops or something to even do better than that. But there's an even better way, and that's to use a Batinoff mask. So we'll get to that in a second. You know, once you get in focus, some lenses you can lock in place by flipping it into autofocus, or there's actually a lock mechanism on the lens, or you could put some painter's tape if you're not, you know, if you not worried about it gumming up things or whatever, so that if you bump it or you're moving around the camera, that you don't knock it out of focus. And if you're going to be putting or removing filters or whatever, or stuff to help with the dew control, which we'll talk about, you know, do all of that before you focus so that you're not messing with the lens after you've achieved focus. Again, shooting tethered with Backyard EOS or Nikon or one of these other programs they have some focus aids that will help you do that. But then there's also these batten off masks, so let's talk about those. So for telescopes, they look like this top picture here, where they're big black pieces of plastic that are the same diameter as the telescope objective. You can find that same type of thing, black plastic, for DSLR lenses, but they don't really work very well. And the thing that works the best is this lonely speck sharp star, which is a laser etched version of that Batten-off mask. And so what I did, you know, because they come in different sizes, so I, you know, made a spreadsheet of all the lenses that I had, and I think the biggest one was 77 inches. So I got a 85, not inches, 77 millimeters. So I got an 85 millimeter filter holder and the 85 millimeter sharp star that I can slide in and out of there. And then I got, you know, step up, step down rings to adapt that filter holder to the different lenses that I have. So what do you do with this Batten-off mask? So maybe I want to go here first. So I never have enough fingers to do this, because I do this and then I need another finger for this part, right? So what this thing does is it turns stars into an X with another line in the middle when it's perfectly in focus. So you can see that on the, well, both of those images, right? So that's a perfectly in focus star through a Batten-off mask. Now, if you're out of focus, that vertical line is going to move to the right or the left, or, you know, the whole thing is just going to be distorted if you're way out of focus. But that's how, you know, one way that we can all do focusing is with this Batten-off mask. So let me back up here. Yeah, so here's the filter holder on the camera, and then rather than try to, once I get it in focus, rather than try to slide that filter out of the holder, there's a thumb screw on the side, and I can just remove the whole filter holder with the filter in it, so as to not disturb the focus that I just set. And these are just shots of the LCD on the back of the camera. Okay, and then they have a chart of you know where they recommend that their Batten-off mask can be used and can't be used for different lens sizes. Okay, we talked about the rule of 500. So this is how long can you expose without having star trails. So this is really simple. If you've got a full frame camera, you just take the number 500 and you divide it by your focal length, and the answer that you get is the number of seconds that you can expose without star trails. Now some people use 600, and then on the next slide we'll see a ridiculously complex method, but that's how you do it, the rule of 500. And then if you've got a crop sensor, you need to take your focal length and multiply it by your crop factor before you do that division, right? So if you've got a Nikon APS, it'd be 1.5. If you've got a Canon, it'd be 1.6. So let's say you've got a 200 millimeter lens, right? So it's 500 divided by the quantity, 200 times 1.6 for a Canon APS-C sensor. Okay. So, you know, that may mean that you still don't have enough light and forces you to use a higher ISO. And I say that's fine. If that's what it takes to get the shot, then turn your ISO up. Again, the next step up would be to then get some kind of a tracking mount or put it on a telescope mount. Okay, then there's this other NPF rule, which is like this ginormous spreadsheet thing. So if you want to check that out, that's fine. So how do we figure out how long to expose? Let's say now we're tracking with the star movement, so we don't care about worrying about star trails anymore. So it's a little different technique than you do during terrestrial daytime photography. So if you're familiar with, if you bring up the histogram of your daytime shots on the back of your camera, you know, you're going to see these three colored curves that are going to cover the complete histogram from left to right. Turns out at night it's very different. So typically it's going to look like this histogram here. There's going to be one peak towards the left. That's going to be the color and the brightness of the background sky. Okay, and your object that you're interested in, unless it's, you know, stars, a galaxy or something, but if it's a nebula, it's going to be on the right hand of that peak on that slope right there. And then the stars will be, you know, going out towards the right against the bottom of the histogram. So how do we do this? So what we want to do is just create a little space on the left-hand side of the histogram. And the reason for that is you want to make sure that the background sky is higher in intensity than in brightness than any noise that your camera and all that is generating. So we just leave a little black spot space there, and we want that peak to be in the first third of the histogram. So that takes care of the dark side. Now on the other end, what you don't want to see is a little stars piling up into a little line at the white end, at the right hand side, because that means that your stars are saturated, and for one thing they're going to lose their color, right? Because if all three colors are saturated, then they're going to be white, even though they might be blue, red, or orange or something, right? And then the other thing is that they're going to be bigger. And when you go to do a lot of processing as you're trying to stretch histograms and stuff to bring out your nebula or something, then the stars are going to get bloated and ugly. So those are kind of the two parameters. You don't want to have all your stars saturated. It's okay to have, you know, one or two bright stars that are saturated, but you don't want like all your stars to be saturated. And then we want a little space on the histogram on the left-hand side. Okay, so that's kind of an exposed to the right model for astrophotography. Okay, then, so what ISO do you use? Well, you can read endless discussions online, and some of it is too scientifically complex for you know, my eyes glaze over after about the third page, but basically, I say, you know, use whatever ISO you need to get the shot and don't worry about it too much. But, you know, one opinion out there is you should always shoot at unity gain. Well, then you have to figure out, well, what is unity gain for my particular camera? And that can be a whole scientific journey in itself. You know, when I was using Canon DSLRs, I usually shot at night around ISO 1600. Some people go lower. When I was using Nikons, I usually shot at ISO 800, even though the Nikons are typically quieter than the Canons anyway. But while talking about ISO, there's some other tips I want to give you. So ISO is one of the things that we would set differently than advice you might get for daytime photography, right? So your camera probably has these high ISO functions that are turned off by default. I want you to turn them all on. You want to get the highest ISO you can. And there's a couple times that it's useful to have that high ISO, even though it's going to be very noisy. And that is when you're focusing and in saving time to figure out what your exposure should be. So, like, we don't want to spend, 5 minutes figuring out that a 5-minute exposure is not long enough. that I really needed an 8-minute exposure, right? So what we can do is use the high ISO function to estimate what exposure we want at the ISO that we're actually going to use. So like I said, I normally used ISO 1600, but to estimate an exposure, this was a Canon T3i. Its highest ISO was 1280. Actually, that's a typo. It should be 12,800. So I would set it at 12,800 and do, you know, like a 60-second exposure and see how that turned out, right? And then if that's right, then you can do math to turn that into what the exposure would be, right? So that's between 1600 and 12,800 is three ISO stops, right? So it's three doublings, right? So you go from 1600 to 3200 to 64 to 12,800. So you take my 60-second exposure, you multiply it by 8, because that's three doublings, right? 2 to the third. And so you come out with 8 minutes, or 480 seconds. And so that's, you know, in 60 seconds, I figured out what my exposure was versus waiting 5 minutes or 10 minutes to find out that I really wanted 8 minutes. And again, also using high ISO when you're focusing, to get a faster result, because you don't care how noisy things are when you're focusing. Okay. So other camera settings for nighttime. So, you know, obviously you're going to want to be manual. There's no auto focusing in cameras at night. Manual focus, you're going to want to shoot raw. Turn off long exposure noise reduction. Now, this might seem kind of counterintuitive. Your camera may have one or more long exposure noise reduction or noise reduction settings in the menus, and you want to turn them all off, and here's why. We want to do the function that is doing for you, but we don't want to spend the time under the dark sky to do that. We want to do that later when we're processing. So the way long exposure noise reduction works is you're going to take, you know, like that 8-minute exposure, and then it's going to close the shutter, and it's going to take another 8-minute exposure and subtract them and give you that. But it just took you 16 minutes to do that. So I don't want to waste that time under the night sky doing the dark subtraction. So what do? So we turn it off, and we only take what we call them lights, right? We take our light exposures, and then we go home and we put our camera in a camera bag with some desiccant, and we put it in the refrigerator. I'm not joking. Put it in the refrigerator with a USB cord coming out, and with the lens covered, and we wait till the temperature gets to be what it was about at where you were at night, and you take 25 exposures of the same duration that you did at night, and those are your dark frames. And so then in software, we're gonna, you know, do that subtraction, and you could build up a library of, you know, different temperatures, different ISOs, different exposures, whatever you think you need, and then pull those out during processing to match them up with your lights. You're going to want to use a remote release or an intervalometer, or shoot tethered. So there may be some settings around that. And then there's a longer list there on the right, or on the web, of other changes you're going to want to make. We talked about that you need to think about dew control. Well, this is kind of an old slide now, because now I see all over Amazon there's these USB lens warmers, so that you could do something like that. What's shown here is hand warmers when you go skiing or something. This one guy makes this little pouch you can put them in. I don't think in California you'd ever need three. I think one would be more than enough. Or you could just wrap some painter's tape. I've done that. And it might, you know, you want the lens just slightly warmer than the surrounding temperature. If you heat it up too much, then, you know, you could create your own problems. You could distort the optics, or you could create heat, you know, heat flow patterns. That same guy used to sell these lighted hats with a red light, but he doesn't do that anymore. And this is the same power cap, I think, is the same manufacturer, but he doesn't seem to offer the same combination. When I was first starting out, I was hanging out with visual observers who are very concerned about their dark adapted eyes, and they want only red lights. And I had, you know, I had a flashlight, and I got one that had both white and red. And it, even though the buttons were different, you know, one was knurled and one was smooth, I kept turning on the white light and getting yelled at. So for, on the hat, the red was on the right, so that was easier to remember. Excuse me. But I like these hats because, you know, you just turn it on and you can do your thing and you don't have to carry something around. Okay. So this, the end of this here is just kind of the same information in a table format. So I'm sure Polaris is more than visible now. So at this point, you can wander around and nicely ask people what they're doing, and maybe they'll share some with you. And hopefully Jerry's going to be able to demonstrate kind of the whole soup to nuts process here of deep space. So I can take questions. I've been talking a long time.
How long have you been doing this
for? I think I started in maybe 2015. Yeah.
What is the regular error of breaking? So if you take a good mount, so how much do you go?
Well,
what
I didn't mention before was, you know, the resolution of your whole optical system, right? So how many arc seconds per pixel you have. So that if you're imaging at 4 arc seconds per pixel, you don't really care if you're, you know, moving around 2 arc seconds or something, right? But in general, what I said was accurate, that we would like to have, you know, less than an arc second, maybe a half an arc second. Well, so we're all, you know, we're all using some form of auto guiding. So to me, it doesn't matter how long your exposure is, because it.
No, I'm asking about tracking without auto guiding.
Oh, without auto guiding.
How accurate should it be?
Well, I guess you would want it to be accurate for the length of your exposure time, right? So if you're exposing for 3 minutes, then you'd want it to be under an arc second for 3 minutes. And there's peak and RMS too, right? But yeah, I mean, what it comes down to is, are your stars round and small? If they're round and small, then don't sweat the, you know, arc second thing, right? If they're oblong, then there's something wrong and you need to look at your tracking, right?
No, because that's why I'm asking.
Yeah,
I have error like 2 arc seconds in 1 minute.
Okay.
So is it something wrong with the tracking, or it's a regular error?
Well, again, I would add, I don't know the focal length of your scope and your camera and all that. If your stars are small and round, be happy. Okay? If your stars are not small and round, then we need to look at it. And you said you were not guiding, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Well, so you need to guide. And then, you know, it's like, well, how big is my guide scope? Is it a separate guide scope? Am I using off-axis guiding? Am I using an on-ag? You know, there's different techniques, but usually people start with like a 50 millimeter guide scope. And one of the biggest improvements in guiding you can have is change that to a 200 millimeter or 400 millimeter guide scope, like a short tube 80 or something, and that helps a lot. Okay. Any other questions?
Can you briefly describe auto guiding?
Sure. I don't have a good illustration here. So the mount, is going to be. Well, I'm going to go the wrong way. The mount is going to be moving with the stars, in the right ascension axis, right? So it's geared and timed to move at the same rate as the stars, but it's not going to be perfect. And then also the other angle that axis that it has is called the declination axis, right? So they call the RA moves east to west and the declination moves north to south. So both because of mechanical issues in the gears and how they mesh and all that, and in because of seeing, you could be off in either one of those dimensions by or axes by a certain amount at any given time. So what we do with auto guiding and the way astronomers used to do it is they have a smaller, wider field scope on the side of their telescope, and they'd sit there and look at it all night long and have some kind of a control. I'm talking about, Mount Wilson, Palomar, right? I mean, back in the day, they put one star in the center and they go, okay, that's my star, and they stay there all night and they control the telescope, speed it up, slow it down, move it to keep that star in the crosshairs. Okay, and so that's called guiding. Okay, so they're going to guide the scope all night long. So now we have software that can do that same thing, so we call it auto guiding. Right, so you've got a typically, like I said, there's lots of ways to do it, but the simplest way is you have a separate scope with a separate camera and a separate piece of software, and it's a wider field view, and so you've got, maybe 20 stars. So so the typical software is called PhD, which is for push here dummy, auto guider. So you say auto select a star, so it picks a star that's not saturated but not too dim, so it's got a histogram, right, that it can keep track of, and as this star moves it left and right on the histogram, then it knows that you're moving the wrong direction, and it can correct it learns how you do this calibration step where it learns, hey, if I tell the mount to speed up, or I tell the mount to slow down, or I tell the mount to go here, it sees how the stars move, so it learns the orientation of the scope and the camera and everything relative to the mount. And then once it's calibrated, then you just tell it, okay, guide. So now it's going to watch that star, and it's going to send auxiliary commands to the mount to speed up, slow down, turn deck a little bit or whatever to track. So it's going to improve the tracking capability of the mechanics of the mount to be better by auto guiding. Okay. All right. Anything else? All right. So we'll turn this off. And Jerry, how you doing there? Okay. He's doing autofocus. Thank you.